guys, congratulations on getting to the final part of this giraffe tutorial. So the final part is doing the entire neck and the hair on the back of the neck. So the approach that we're going to take with this one is we are going to put down a like foundation color all around the spots, and the entire area on the neck around the spots is etched with our sculpting tool first. So we want that texture to come out. So just keep that in mind before you put your color down, to make sure that that entire area is etched out, but not the spots. Do not etch the spots. The spots have a much smoother look, so we don't want that to end up looking too hairy or too not as smooth, if I can put it that way. Once we put the base colors down, then we're actually going to do the hair, and we're going to finish that off, and then we're going to jump into the rest of the neck and do all the details then. So the neck is much like we did with the chin, and then obviously with the hairs on the back of the neck, I'll show you exactly how to do that and get to and show you how easy it is to get it to look so real and so soft and fluffy with the really soft little wispy ends. So let's get into the last tutorial, and I will speak to you guys in the end. Okay, so we are finally onto the last tutorial of the giraffe, and we're gonna do the entire neck. So I've put it in a horizontal way because I think this is gonna be the easiest way for you to see the entire neck on the camera, and it's also gonna be the easiest way for me to draw at this angle. So the reason I want you to see the entire neck the whole time is because I'm gonna work over the entire surface of the neck throughout this tutorial. I'm not just going to start and finish one part of the neck and then go onto the next one. I want to do the whole thing at the same time, because majority of the neck is pretty much the same colors. So we are just going to work from the top area, work our way down, and then come back from the top, work our way down, and we're just going to continue working on that way until the entire neck is finished. Okay, so the first thing I want to do is I actually want to color in the entire surrounding area around all the spots. So I'm going to use my peach beige, my PC1085, and I'm going to lightly layer between all the spots from top to bottom. And then I have etched the entire neck with my sculpting tool, so there will be a texture coming up later, but I haven't done the spots. So I've done the entire neck around the spots. I have etched with my sculpting tool, and that texture is just gonna really come out beautifully later on. So we're not worried about details at the moment. We just want to get a light layer of this color down. And then we're going to get a light layer of all the spots down. And then it's easy for us to identify which areas we're working on at which time. And then we will start working on more color definition and detail. Okay, so there we can already start seeing the spots are starting to come out a little bit more. And before I continue, I want to lighten up this graphite line, particularly in the areas that are not right against the spots, because I know that it's going to be quite light compared to my pencil line. So I don't want my graphite pencil to stick out on the edge. I'm going to use my dark brown PC 946, And I'm going to fill in the shape of all the spots, also very lightly. Okay, I like that. Now we are going to use our chocolate brown to define the hairs on the back of the neck or the mane. So we're going to just about halfway up, so against the neckline, and just halfway up from there. Don't go to the edge of the hairs, because that we're going to do in the other direction. Because what we're doing now, make sure that you do it very, very smooth, because this is not the right direction of the hair. Usually you want to draw in the right direction, but for now we just want to fill in the color. So only go about halfway. Pay attention to your reference. Oh, and the chocolate brown is PC1082. Can see here I have a very distinct line that almost, with a black background, it almost looks like it ends here, but the hairs over here just sort of fade into the background. And these are going to be very dark. Okay, now that we've done that, we are going to make sure our pencil is very nice and sharp, and we're going to do the hairs in the opposite direction, in the direction that they're supposed to be. So we're going to go up and down motions, and the tops of the edges, we're going to pay attention to the tops of the edges of the hair so that it's not just one straight line, because that'll just look weird. So just pay attention to your reference. Okay, so now you're going to go in an upwards motion, so, and make those edges really, really soft. Now, this line against the hair is quite a defined line, so the hairs are not going to go over that. So make sure that you know where that line is. And connect the hairs only to that line. Okay, so we're going to do this all the way to the bottom, and then we can add different colors as we go, or after we've reached the bottom, we'll come back up and add the different colors. What you can do, if you want to know where these edges end, if your graphite line is quite light, just do little soft strokes like that on the top of your graphite line, where you can see where the tops of those pieces of hair end. That's also going to show you just how inconsistent it is. It's not just one straight line. Okay, so that makes it easier for me to see, and now I can follow along and make sure that I end on those edges. Okay, so right now it looks very stringy, but now I can sharpen my pencil again so that I can make the rest of this look as nice and soft as this does. But at least I can see now where it starts and where it ends, so I can make it look nice and consistent. When you see me working in circular motions like this, I'm using a very, very light hand, but I'm sort of just trying to get even coverage from the straight line on the neck to the points of the hair. But I'm doing it in soft circular motions, so it doesn't look like I'm cross-hatching by drawing this way and then drawing this way. So be very careful when you do this that it doesn't look like you're going in opposite directions with your coloring. Soft circular motions. Okay, so that's starting to take some more shape. So now I want to make some of the areas darker, so I'm going to use my PC1099 Espresso color. And I'm not going to make all of it darker, but I'm going to pay attention to my reference and just add some darkness to areas. So over here, this is actually a small part of a spot. So I'm just going to darken that up so it sticks out a little bit better. Hello, Taylor. You finished with the beanbag? Go lay down. I must tell you, and I'll put a photo up, but one of my girls, Taylor, she loves sticking her head into the beanbag. Like, she will shove her head in there and do twists and turns and try and get her head as deep into the beanbag as she can. And then she'll just lie there and sleep like that. She's so weird. Oh dear. You weirdo, hey? Oh dear. Okay, so the hairs on this side are so dark that you can barely see them. So we are going to, and they go in this direction. So if you want to see them a little more clearer, just change the exposure on the reference photo and then it will show you. But we're going to add this really dark all the way to all the way to the edge. Hopefully you can see that right on the edge of the paper. Really dark. And then here it's quite dark as well. So now I just want to sort of, almost like a glaze, but I want to add this color in between some of the colors, just gently, so that the dark areas that we just filled in don't just stand out like little stringy bits. So like I said before, just small circular motions. So it doesn't look like you're cross-hatching, you're just trying to add more of this color in gently. Okay, before we go any further, I want to blend that hair in with my solvent. And I'm going to use my little green brush. So my number 2 protégé. I just got a whole bunch of green brushes in one set. I don't know if they're for watercolor or what they're for, but I just got a cheap set of green brushes and that's what I use. So when we blend this, we want to blend and still create those really, really soft edges. Now this is going to be quite time consuming because we have so little on our brush, we can only do really tiny sections at a time. But look how that color's already coming out. And it's just going to look good in the end. And you want to be patient with this because you want those hairs to continue looking soft. You don't want it to sort of mush into such a soft blend that it looks unnatural. And then some of the edges you can even bring out with the tip of your brush. So that slight little color is going to create what looks like little extensions of the hair coming out of the edges. So I've zoomed in so that you guys can get a better look of what I'm doing. So soft little blending strokes, very little on my brush. And I even go into the white areas. So there it looks like soft little ends of hair as I blend, because it's the smallest tip of my brush is extending those hairs just a little bit. So even if the edge looks really, really weird all the way down, when we fill in the rest of the neck, it's going to start blending in and looking very natural. So don't worry about how strange it looks by just having this long mane of hair going all the way down the neck and it just doesn't look like it's connecting the back of the neck properly. That'll all start to flow later on as we add more detail to the neck. So that looks nice and textured. Remember, we haven't used our sculpting tool in this area of the drawing, so we haven't used it on these hairs. You could actually, if you wanted to create more of that texture. But this is the other way of doing it. If you didn't etch your paper, then you'd use strokes and blending like this to create the illusion of that texture. But yeah, it probably would have actually been easier if I just etched this out of the paper as well. That would have really made the hair look soft and hairy. But you can still get similar effects without using the sculpting tool. You just use your pencils properly and you'll give the illusion of those textures naturally. Okay, so we sort of have the hardest part of it done now. Now we just have to make it even darker because it's not quite dark enough. I'm going to come in with my black first. And pretty much what I've done with the espresso color before, I'm going to do the same thing with the black. That's just going to make it look like we're pushing some hairs to the background and some to the foreground. Some are more highlighted, some are more shadowed. So putting the black over it like this is just going to define that more. Okay, and I want to lightly color in some of the bottom areas and sort of just connect it smoothly to the line of the neck. Oh, that's looking amazing. Now I think I want to blend that one more time. Actually, no. Now we're going to use our burnt ochre PC943 and we want to add that red tinge everywhere. So gently go through with the side of your pencil. Don't go to the points of the hair because you don't want to lose those nice soft edges. Using soft circular motions, we're going to add this color in everywhere. Okay, and now we're going to blend again with the solvent. We also want to focus on the neckline and try and create that illusion of a nice straight line along the neck. So So try not to blend over the neckline. Okay, I really, really love that. Now we are coming to a really fun part. So I'm going to use my cream color PC914 and I want to add some highlights to the hair. So I'm going to zoom into this area and show you what I mean, and then I'll zoom back out and do the whole area. Okay, so we want to create some highlighted hairs. So we're going to just use this yellow and some areas add some highlighted pieces. Some of the top parts of the hair over here, or the giraffe mane, I guess it is, have lights just catching the top, so you want to create those highlights just on the top sections. Yeah, we've got a whole highlighted hair. Yeah, we've got some as well. So just like we used our black to create shadow, we're using our yellow to create highlights. Okay, and that is it for that part of the giraffe. It looks really, really cool. It looks soft, it looks real. And then as we progress through the rest of the neck, it's really gonna start to look amazing. So, yep, let's move on to the rest of the neck. Okay, so now we're gonna start working on the spots and we're gonna define the spots. And then we'll do everything surrounding the spot. So I'm going to use my Sapir Brown PC948 and I'm gonna start at the top and work my way down. So I'm still paying a lot of attention to my reference photo and making sure that even though I'm only using one color, I'm still creating some areas darker than others because I'm focusing on the value. So, and I'm sure you remember when we did the chin that it's got some really defined edges. So we still wanna sort of define those edges in an earlier stage compared to when we defined them afterwards. That'll save us a little bit of time. Speaking of time, I do want to warn you about something. When you get to this stage of a drawing where you can see the end is near, you have to make yourself be very, very patient because this is the part of a drawing where you can easily start to rush. And then when you rush, you make mistakes or you don't finish it properly. And then you take photos of it and you say, this is the end. And then you look at it another day or two, and you're like, oh no, I need to fix that, I need to fix that, and I need to fix that. And you want to take your time with the last part of the drawing and you want to pay extra attention to everything as you go, and also in the end you want to look over the entire thing from scratch and do your touch-ups. And if you feel like you're impatient, then leave it to the next day before you do the touch-ups, and that way you know that you finished it off properly without being in too much of a rush to put it online and show everybody because you're so excited. So just bear that in mind. I am sorry if my voice is a bit funny or if my nose sounds a little blocked up, but I have been sick in the last few days, so I haven't been recording and it's been a bit uncomfortable, but I can't leave it much longer. I need to get it finished, so please pardon the sound of my voice. I'm feeling much better. I just don't sound as great, that's all. The worst part is I haven't been sick, not even with a cold or flu, for like 3 years almost. And this one just hit me. The season change was very, very quick this year. It felt like it was extremely hot and then extremely cold very quickly. And I think it just kind of got to my immune system a little bit quick. So I've been eating super healthy, drinking lots of tea, eating lots of veggies, and limiting the fruit and the dairy. And I think it's made the healing process much faster, or the getting over the flu much faster. So all good. Feel good. Feel better. So this spot here is quite textured, so we're not going to just fill it in. We're actually going to create up and down strokes like we see it in the reference, to give it the illusion of that texture. You're bumping the table, Missy. Also remember, you don't have to do it in the order that I'm doing it in. If you're drawing with me, then it will probably be easier, but you don't have to. If you get bored of doing the same thing for a while, like you might get bored of doing the spots when you reach halfway, then swap it around. Do between the spots or maybe even do another drawing. So I go through phases where sometimes I need two drawings going at the same time. So it's not that I'm not in the mood to draw, but I just get sick of putting so much time into just one specific thing. So to change it up, I would just go to the next drawing. And then, yeah. So it's good to change it up like that every once in a while. This spot is very dark, so we can make this value quite dark. The spot is right against the hairline, which is nice, so that looks like a very good transition between the two. And then as we just continue on, it's just going to look more and more natural all the way through. This spot is quite dark as well. So I also wanted to thank you guys, and I'm going to be putting a video up of it, but you guys helped me reach my $500 Patreon goal, which means I could purchase the full set of the Caran d'Ache Luminance pencils, which I did. So I'm waiting for them in the mail, and then as soon as I get them, I will be doing a thank you video and showing you guys a little more about those pencils. But as I was looking for a place to buy the pencils, because they are such a stupidly expensive brand, because the quality is just amazing, it is a very, very expensive pencil, it just made me love the Prisma colors even more. I don't think I'll ever go off of Prismas, and then my Luminance pencils I think I will use on smaller pieces to make them last longer. But on really big pieces like this, I'd probably stick to my Prismacolor pencils, because the price is so cheap on Prismas right now because of the manufacturing issues. But I still love the Prismas because of the color range. It's got the biggest amount of color range out there. And I am happy to deal. Sorry about that. The the doorbell rang because the mailman come and my dog knocked over the camera. And yep, I muted that because that would have been so noisy hearing her bark like that, but the camera falling over was her. What was I saying? I was talking about the Caran d'Ache Luminance pencils and the Prismacolor Premier pencils. So Prismacolor pencils used to be very expensive, so they used to be the best wax base pencil that you could get, but due to manufacturing problems and a lot of people complaining that they break too easily, or the core falls out, or it doesn't sharpen very well, there's a lot of issues that the pencil has had manufacturing wise, but I feel like I'm happy to deal with those issues for the price that it is now, because you still get such a massive color range. Like, it's the biggest color range in pencils that you get out there. Compared to the Caran d'Ache, which is the best wax-based pencil out there, you pay $4, sometimes $5 for one pencil, compared to Prisma's, which is $1.80 for a pencil. But the Caran d'Ache Luminance only has 76 76 colors max, and the Prismacolor Premier has 150 colors. So I'd rather just buy two pencils that are going to last me as long as one. Or let me put it this way, I'd rather buy three Prismacolor pencils that keep breaking and go through three color Prismacolor pencils for the price of one Caran d'Ache Luminance pencil, and get a much bigger color range. And it's not every pencil. I find that you probably deal with about maybe three or four pencils that could possibly be really bad in the Prismacolor set, and the rest is just issues that you can sort of just fix yourself. So if the core comes out, you can melt it so that it you can stick it in the microwave for a few seconds and get it to melt and set again against the core or against the wooden casing, and then that should be fine. I found though with sharpening Prismacolor pencils is a big challenge, because if you don't have a good sharpener, it does break a lot more than what you would like, and sometimes it can drive you crazy because you're sharpening your pencil right through to the end because it just keeps breaking that much. But my solution to that is buy a fantastic sharpener, and my favorite sharpener that I use is the School Smart electric sharpener, and that is just, it gets the point so sharp, and I don't struggle with breakage with my Prismas. It's great. I love it. I really don't struggle half as much as what I did with my Derwent battery-operated sharpener, which I found would break them a lot more because I feel like you're holding it quite forcefully while you're sharpening it, whereas with the School Smart electric sharpener, you're not really holding the pencil that tightly, so there's not that much force, and it's so sharp and so quick that it's not putting much strain on the entire casing or core of the pencil. So that's probably why it's a better sharpener, because it's just protecting the pencil as a whole because of its strength, and also because it doesn't really affect the casing. So my Caran d'Ache Luminance pencils are going to be my pride and joy, and like my nobody can ever touch those pencils kind of set. And I've been wanting to own a set for a very long time, but because they're so expensive, it has been difficult. But thanks to you guys, I've reached that $500 goal on Patreon, so I was able to purchase the set. So I'm really, really excited to get it. And so I'll talk more about it. But for those that want to buy a set of pencils, I still recommend getting the full set of Prismacolor pencils and just replacing them as they go, because the price now is totally worth the manufacturing problems that they have, in my opinion. And I would also highly recommend you get a very good sharpener. So I have a video on my YouTube channel about the sharpener and about its comparison to the Derwent battery-operated sharpener. So what I'm doing now is I'm still just filling in the spots, adding darker values, and just getting these spots filled in with the right colors. And I still want to correct my edges and make sure that if it's a sharp edge, I'm making it a sharp edge. If it's got little bits sticking out of the edges, I'm putting that in as well. But for now, I'm still using my sepia color, which is my PC948. And going along all the way to this, to the bottom spots. My dogs have no consideration for space. So I have one of my girls lying in the sun against the window, Tyler, and Honey literally goes and lies right on top of her because she wants to lie there. She doesn't care that she's lying on top of her legs or anything. She's going to lie right on top of her because she wants to be there. Not caring that Tyler's already there. Poor Bobby. If you guys have any pets and you have any funny stories about them with you in the studio, I'd love to know, because my two just crack me up every day. There's always something different with them, and it's just, yeah, they really brighten up my studio life. I'm sort of grateful I don't have a cat, because I can just imagine what it would be like then as well. I do love cats. I love cats, dogs, I love any animals. If it were up to me, I'd have a whole horde of them. But if I had a cat, I'm sure it'd be impossible for me to draw. I've seen some videos where the cat just literally comes and sits right on top of what you're doing and doesn't want to allow you to go any further. I'd love to see photos as well if you have any. Please put them up. Okay, now we want to start adding all the richer colors within all those spots. So we are going to use our burnt ochre PC943, and we are going to just lightly add this color, almost like we're glazing, but we're just lightly adding this color to the top of all of them. That's going to bring the redness out and the nice deep rich colors. Don't worry about detailing, you can be very, very rough with this. Just stay within your area. Okay, now we are going to use our black and we're going to define the darker values. So PC935, and now we are going to sort of define the edges and also the darker areas of each spot. Okay, so that's really going to help us with the darker values, or to make it look really realistic once we put the solvent down. But before we do that, we still want to add those richer colors. So now that we've added so much black, it's kind of graded out. So we want to add those richer colors back into it. So we're going to use our chocolate brown. And we're going to color it in all around the softer edges. The more, look how rich that color is already. So it's really adding that nice rich brown color to the rest of it. Make sure you keep the lighter spots light. Do not make them too dark. I didn't add any black to that, so I'm just gonna make that darker. When you get to this amount of layering, you just can't help but get so excited that the blending with the solvent is coming close, because you really want to see how it's gonna pop out and just get that automatic realistic look the minute we put the solvent down. But we're getting close to adding the solvent. Okay, now we are finally ready to add our solvent. I'm going to use my number 2 West Art brush. Dip it in the solvent, dab a lot of it off, and then blend. If you find the brush is too thick to get your edges nice and smooth, then go with a thinner brush, which I think I am going to do, actually. So I'm going to use my number 2 Protégé 515 round China brush and blend with that, because I find I'll get my edges much sharper than compared to the other brush that I just used. This brush will though. Okay, how amazing do those spots look already? So now the real exciting part is doing the area surrounding the spots, and we're going to make this all just come together. Okay? Okay, so we're going to start off with our 20% French Grey PC1069. And we are going to start from the top. So I just want to put the color in, really. Try not to lose your lines over here. So let's actually press a little bit firmer and just put in those darker values that you know are here on the crease of the neck. Okay, so that's given us an indication of the creases on the neck there, and now we can just gently go and fill this color in everywhere else. These creases are going to get a bit darker. There's quite a dark shadow over here, so we're just also going to do the same as what we did here and just form those shapes so that we have a clear indication of where exactly they are located, and then we can darken them up later. Be very careful along the edge because you want to keep that very sharp, sharp line. Okay, so this is pretty much the color we just did now is going to be the lightest color on the neck. So whichever areas are going to stay really light, this is the lightest color that it's going to be. And we should leave it that color. Whereas anything darker, obviously we can work on those darker values. So if we look at our reference, we'll see that there's a lot of these lighter colors over here. And then the creases are going to be darker, but it kind of goes from a lightish color and then it sort of goes darker as you go down. So now we're going to come in with our ginger root and we're going to start adding those colors. So this color starts forming, you know, a little bit over here, but not too much. And then over here. And then don't cover all the areas, but just like sort of cover patches in this color. Just to give some areas this nice hint of color. Okay, now we want to add a light umber, so we're going to add more color into these areas. So pay attention to your reference now, because now you're going to use very soft motions in the right direction, and you're going to start adding these colors. So you're not coloring in anymore like we did with the last two colors, we are just adding little indications of this color. Creating little streaks, little strokes like this. That's going to add to the textured look. Even though we did etch this out of the sculpting tool, it's still going to add to it. Okay, now I want to add the reddish value. So this one you're going to be very, very careful, because you want to create the softest color. So this is the Burnt Ochre PC 943. And we're going to softly add almost like a glaze of this color over some of the areas of the neck. It's barely noticeable now, but this is going to come out when we use the solvent. And we're going to do the same thing with our goldenrod PC 1034. And we want to add some of that golden color. Not too much, just very, very little. Or very gently. Okay, that is looking so good. I really, really, really love that. So areas that can still get a tinge darker, but not too much, and be very, very careful of this, is the front of the neck over here, and a little bit over here, this area here. So we're going to use our 70% French grey, and we are likely going to put this color in. Now we are paying attention to our reference photo. We're only putting this color in on those areas that are darker because it almost looks like there's a highlight, a straight highlight along the neck that goes down there. So we want to try and have that highlight show up, and then we'll enhance that highlight with the white later on. Okay, now I want to use my white Prismacolor pencil and block in the areas that are going to have a lighter color. So just gently want to actually bring out that highlight over here. And we can see that it runs down over here, along the side. There's a highlight that goes across like that. One that goes across like that here. Okay, now we're going to blend again with our solvent. Okay, now I just want to use my white pencil and create soft little strokes in some areas just to sort of give more of that illusion of the texture of the hair. And I'm going to do that everywhere around the spots. Again, it's a small change, but it makes such a difference. Okay, now we're going to add the darker values to the creases in the neck over here. So we're going to use our espresso color. We're going to gently add those nice dark values there. I'm sure that when you're done with this tutorial, you're going to be so familiar with your pencils, you're probably going to even know some of the numbers of them. Okay, now I'm just going to use my 20% French Grey PC1069 again, and I want to go around these edges properly just to make them really, really defined. Okay, coming back in with my espresso color. I want to make this darker. And this one too. Then I'm going to use my 70% Warm Grey PC1056 and just add that greyish tinge to these shadows over here. We don't just want to leave everything one color. Okay. Now I want to use my white again, and I want to highlight even more on the areas of the neck here. So this area right here is light. Here we want to make these look like proper creases, so we're going to add the highlights on those areas that grab most of the light. We are done. No. So now we can see that there is quite a highlight over here. So I'm actually going to draw the line this way and go over here. And then I'm going to draw it like that. Go the other way. And then I need to enhance this one even more. Right under here, I need to enhance this one even more. And then above it as well. Okay, and just here as well. Okay, and then I'm gonna blend those creases with solvent just to make them a bit smoother. And then I'm just going to carefully look at which other areas look a little bit too crayon-y. And then you'll see some of them look a bit almost like a sandy texture because you haven't put solvent on there. So look for those areas and then blend them in properly. Okay, I am so pleased to say that we are done. Another thing I just want to say before you officially post anything onto your social media or anything, do yourself the favor and leave it till tomorrow to come in and do your finishing touches. Make sure that you observe everything from top to bottom and do all your final touches, because you'd be amazed at what a big difference that makes once it's all done. Because when you get to this point of the drawing, you're so excited to get finished that you just want to finish, and then you kind of don't pay attention to all the subtle differences. But if you can wait till the next day and work on those differences, it does make a big difference and it really adds to your drawing. So I really hope that you guys enjoyed this, and I'm so pleased that we finally reached the last part of the tutorial, and yes, we're done. Hey guys, so remember I said in the last tutorial that you don't want to be in a rush. You want to wait till the next day and do the touch-ups the next day before you post your final picture. So I went and did exactly that. I thought I was finished. I was quite happy with the end result, and I posted the picture up on Facebook and everywhere else. And then this morning I had another look with fresh set of eyes, and there is so much left that I want to change. So I actually think this is going to be a great example, because I'm going to show you the difference between what I posted up yesterday as the final results and the difference between doing the touch-ups in the end. So right now I'm going to go through the entire neck, because I'm very satisfied with the whole head. I'm not fussed about the head at all, but the neck is not as textured as I'd like it to be, and I don't think the spots are as defined as I'd like it to be either. So I'm going to go from top to bottom of the neck, and I'm going to zoom in and show you the whole process. I need to make this more textured. I need to add more color and more definition, because I find that the top of the head has a lot of texture and a lot of definition, and it looks very soft and furry. And the neck should actually be looking the same, and it doesn't. So we're going to go in and we're going to fix that, and we're going to make this look the way it should. And then we're going to compare the difference, and you're going to see how important it is to leave it till the next day to do the touch-ups. Okay, so on the neck, I'm going to start with this section here, and I feel like my solvent has gone into the textured areas a bit too much, and it's lost that feeling of soft texture. So I'm going to use my etching tool again, and I'm going to redo those textures, and then I will start focusing on the individual spots and the layering of additional colors, just to add even more realism. And then this way as well, instead of doing the whole neck, going up and down the whole neck, we're actually just going to focus on every area, and we'll only move down in sections once we've completed that whole section, instead of coming back through such a big area. So all I'm going to do now is I'm going to go over all the white areas around the spots that I feel need more texture. And if I notice that there's any texture sort of in the spots, I will add that as well. So that's what I'm going to do. As you can see, I'm just using soft little strokes like this. You won't be able to see me add the texture in there, but it does add a little bit more to it. So that's what I'm going to do now, and then I will come back when I'm done. Okay, so I've gone and re-etched all the white areas, and now I want to work on this area over here and start looking very closely at each individual piece. So the way I'm doing that actually is I have my iPad over here, and now it would be a bit difficult to see. But I'm literally just going to look at which section I'm focusing on and just focus on that section and move my way down like that. And then that is how we're going to really get those details in. So looking at this little curvy part on the top of the neck there, it's got a lot more gray shadows over there. And that spot can definitely be defined even more. So I'm going to use my... Thank goodness I didn't put my pencils away. But I'm going to use my warm gray. my 70% warm gray PC1056, and I am going to work on this area right here. So yeah, it goes down like that, and then there's a shadowed line over here. This spot is really, really dark and sort of travels up slightly that way. Makes me want to go into this spot as well, because even this one can be darker. Over here. Okay, this spot, like I seriously neglected this area because this doesn't look near finished compared to the reference photo. So let's finish this spot so that it looks finished. You're going to see me jump around with colors a lot during this process. Because I want to finish one tiny thing at a time, it might need multiple colors, so I'll be jumping from color to color. Okay, now I want to work on the values over here. Okay, using my Sandbar Brown PC1094, I want to add the brown into this area. Okay, so the brown pretty much stays in that area here, and then over here it actually turns into like a cooler gray color. So I'm going to use this one. I think this is my 10% French gray, and I'm going to try see if that works. Okay, I won't be able to go any lighter than it is here, but what I am going to do is I'm going to use my 70% cool gray. And before I do these spots in this area, I want to focus a bit more on the fur around it. So I'm going to create random areas that have darker little shadows in between the hair. And this is going to help bring that texture back to life. So this area's got the cooler, lighter colors, and this area, the rest of the neck's sort of got the darker, warmer brown colors. So I'm using my Sandbar Brown PC1094, and I'm doing the same things by creating individual strands that are a little bit darker in some areas. And that's also going to help bring that texture back out. that area of texture is already looking much, much better. So we're not going to blend with solvent again because we just don't want that color to go in the edges. And because we have all our color really put into the paper's texture already from the previous layers, we don't really have to do that. Okay, so now we're going to work on these few spots to make them look more realistic. I'm going to be using my Sepia PC948. And I'm paying attention just to this spot alone. Using a very sharp pencil. That spot looks way more textured already. Now I want to make it even darker. So I'm going to use my Espresso PC1099. And just enhance those values that just need to be a tinge darker. Okay, moving on to this little spot. It's got some rough edges, just slight rough edges. And that's all you need to do for that one. So this one over here, I'm coming back in with my Sepia PC948. And those edges aren't very defined. So I'm going to create the textured edges. And I'm also going to make it look like the reference photo spot. Make sure I'm focusing on my edges. I don't think I put enough attention into these spots at all. I was clearly way too excited to just get this up and finished. Okay, now I want to use my Light Umber PC941 and just add that lighter color on the edges over here. And then I will use my Espresso PC1099 and create the darker areas on the inside. As I notice other things, you'll see me jump to other areas. You'll start doing that the more you draw as well, naturally. Okay, moving on to this spot. This spot is dark, so we are going to use our Espresso 1099, and we're going to define those edges again. We'll make the edges look more textured along the sides. I
Okay, now I'm actually going to use my black PC935. And there are some areas that have a really, really dark value in here, so I'm going to bring that out. Okay, so the other two spots next to it, the small one and this one over here, it's the same colors. So we're going to come in with our espresso, do the edges. And then come in with a black. This edge here can have a bit of black as well. In this little kinky corner. Oh, I'm just loving the look so much more. It just looks so much better. And it's making me notice that I need to do the same for the chin, actually. I need to define those spots more, just like I did over here, and that's really going to enhance the texture so much more. I also want to actually add some darker areas into the hair over here. Amazing. This spot over here, my goodness, I was really in a rush to finish because even this one just looks very half done. So I'm using my Sepia PC948, creating those tape. This one's very textured. You've got some lighter highlights in there as well, so I'm gonna have to add those too. Okay, and we don't want to go too dark with that one, so we are going to use our espresso PC1099 and then just use this for the darker values instead of the black, because this spot is quite light compared to the others. And then we are going to use our 10% French Grey and try and put in those little highlighted pieces of hair there. Much better. Much better. I'm gonna come back in with my espresso PC1099. This edge is not quite as fluffy as that. So just sort of give it that shape back again. Okay. Let's go into this one, make this a little bit more textured. And this one as well. Okay, I love that. Now, I think I actually want to do the spots on the chin before I move further down. Oops. So let me move that up. Okay, so I'm going to do the same thing as I did with this area of the neck. So I'm going to use my 70% Cool Grey PC 1065. And I want to create the illusion of those tiny little hairs even more, just to give more texture to the chin, because I feel like the lighter areas here are just a bit too smooth. Okay, the colors are going to get warmer down this area, so I'm just going to spread these colors out a little bit more, and then I'm going to come in with a warmer color to continue this on the rest of the chin. Okay, so my warmer color is going to be my Sambal Brown PC 1094. And I'm going to do the same thing on the rest of the chin, just very lightly. Oh my gosh, I love it so much. It looks so good. Okay, coming in with my 70% Cool Grey PC 1065. This area has got the cooler colors, so we're gonna continue on with these tiny little soft strokes up here. And then we can get into defining the spots some more. Okay, back into defining all the little spots on the chin. Now that we've done the rest. I'm using my espresso PC1099. This espresso's got such a rich brown color. It's nothing like the color on the casing. And this is probably one of the colors I use. Where was I? Okay. Let's start off with this spot. Then I'm going to use my black and make it darker. I'm also going to use my 70% warm grey PC1056, and I want to create more texture and darker value over here, because here is a bit of a darker tinge. Okay, sticking to this color, I'm also going to do the edges of this one. Then I'm going to use my black and create those darker values. I just cannot believe that I thought this was finished. Or I was just so excited, I guess, that I made myself think that it was done when it really isn't. Working on these little spots over here, I'm using the 70% warm grey PC1056 and just gonna enhance them as well. Okay, moving on to this spot here. And then using my black to bring out those darker values over here. I feel like this spot needs some espresso. Make it a little more that richer brown, this one as well. Okay, now we're gonna do this spot over here. So use your espresso. And then use the black. Okay, let's move on to these top spots. It's just this one actually. Can use even more, even though we did actually work on that one earlier. And then use espresso. I hope I'm remembering to actually say these pencils. Make it harder for myself to edit later. Okay, now we're going to do these bottom spots over here. I am totally falling in love with the way it's looking now. I am so happy that I've come back to do this, and I really hope that you do it too. Just wait that extra day and just see how these touch-ups make such a huge difference to the extreme quality that your piece can possibly be. Because I think yesterday's result was good, but this just makes it so much better. It just adds that much to it. espresso. Oh, you're so beautiful. Now I'm gonna add more espresso to here. Okay, now I want to do touch-ups on this area. So I know I'm getting carried away, but the closer I get to these areas, the more I notice more things that need to be done. So still using my Espresso PC1099. I am adding more details to these areas here. Love it, love it, love it. Now I am using my 70% warm grey PC1056 and adding even more. Okay, I've just noticed that the bridge of the nose is not nearly dark enough, so I'm gonna make it even darker. Using my black, I am going to come in here and add these individual areas that need to be much darker. Okay, and now we're going back to our espresso PC1099 and we want to add more dark browns. Actually, do you know what I think we need? I think we need Tuscan Red. Where is my Tuscan Red? Okay, so using my Tuscan Red, so this is a new color that I haven't used on this image before. So PC937. I am going to add red. This is such a gorgeous color, and it is, I think, really going to enhance the darker areas on the nose here. Yes. Keep it in the darker areas. You don't want to go over the lighter areas because then it looks like a rash. Okay, that bit of red made a difference. So now I want to use my Burnt Ochre PC943. And we have way more little strands to add here. Just little strokes. Bring this color in more over the lighter areas here. This area here, 70% warm gray, PC1056. Adding some more detail. So you can really take this as far as you want to, but don't. I know it's hard to be like, when is it that I should actually stop? When do I reach the point where I might be taking it overboard? So that is sometimes a hard decision to make, because you obviously don't want to overwork things, but just pay attention to small parts of your reference and just focus on those areas as you go, and then you won't overwhelm yourself with all the details around it. So using my 70% warm gray PC1056, I want to make this area a little bit darker on top of the eye here. Okay, and this area is way too light, so now we're going to take our black PC935 and we are going to darken it up. Pay attention to the little textures that you have over here. Wow, that is looking good. I'm going to darken this up even more. Okay, so continuing on with the neck, I just want to point out that this area looks so much better than the rest of it, doesn't it? Like, it just, it makes such a big difference, and I'm kind of in awe of how the whole thing's looking because it's really starting to look pretty amazing. So I'm using my Light Umber PC941. Now, I know that you guys probably, I don't know how you're going to follow along with this, but this should hopefully give you an idea of the process that you should take before you decide that you've finished, because this is really going to help you make your image go from really good to absolute wow. So I know that the touch-ups I'm doing are for my drawing specifically, and you might not feel like you need these touch-ups for yours, or you need touch-ups in different sorts of areas. So I'll still try and have the colors on the screen as best I can, but I just want to show you the process of doing touch-ups because it just makes such a big difference. I know I keep saying it and you're probably overhearing it, but it is it is just so worth it. Okay, using now I'm gonna go in and define these spots. So I am going to use espresso. Okay, so I do feel like this area, just the fur around, needs more of the burnt ochre. It needs more of a red tinge. So I'm going to use my PC943 and create little strokes with that red color. Okay, so I think by now you guys totally get the idea. So I'm just going to do this all the way to the end of the neck, and then I can finally call it finished. Okay? Welcome to the end of the giraffe tutorial. I am so proud of you guys for getting to this part of the tutorial, which means you are finished. You can take a step back, look at your picture and be like, I drew that. All by myself, I drew that. And it looks realistic and it looks soft, and I think it's very exciting to be able to get to this point in a drawing. So this is what I look forward to most, is actually getting finished and taking a step back and being like, wow. I spent the time and I did that, and it's very, very special. That's what makes art so valuable, especially to the artists, is because of all the time taken to actually take a reference and interpret that in your own way, in the most realistic way possible, and put that on a piece of paper. It's just an unreal feeling. So I know this tutorial was a long tutorial, was a 6-part tutorial, but I think that this is just the best possible way for me to teach you guys how to draw realistically.
take you through all the steps. I've already had patrons try this and show me the results, and the results are insane. For people that haven't had much experience with colored pencils, the results are just unbelievable, and it just proves to me that these kind of tutorials are gonna work for you guys, so I'm gonna stick to doing these sorts of methods for the future. So this is a 6-part tutorial. I'm not gonna go through every part of the tutorial now. You guys know exactly what to focus on as you went through each part of the tutorial. All I want to say is congratulations on finishing it. I'm so glad that you guys got to this point. I'm sure you've learned a lot, and it's going to make it easier to just approach new sorts of subject matter and get it as realistic as possible. And this is just the first step. So this is going to get you really, really far, and I can't wait to see you guys start doing commission pieces and having people ask to get your drawings done. So thank you guys so much for watching. Thank you for doing this tutorial. Please post your pictures up of your final result on Patreon. And if you've completed this entire tutorial, be prepared to get a gift in the mail, because I am so proud to see people finish this that I want to send you something to show you how grateful I am for you to actually take it from the beginning and to the end. And I'm sure the feeling that you're going to have yourself is going to be more than enough satisfaction and appreciation and just achievement for completing this. So thank you guys for watching, and I will see you guys in the next tutorial. Bye!